an historic day, to say the least. And we're going to go over it just a little bit here. It started out with a complete, the whole night I was practicing. I couldn't sleep hardly at all. And I just did the most unbelievable practice I've ever done. It was just, and I didn't know if I could function during the day. I sort of staggered out of bed and just, oh my gosh, I was able to function. But I tried to keep practicing during the day and I couldn't. I couldn't get back to the intensity of it. So I just said, okay, don't even try, because then things will get kind of confusing and you'll sort of undermine yourself. So if you have a really great practice session, don't try to prolong it. Once you're done, just stay in the wow of having done that. But something else happened today that's a miracle, you could have to say. You'd have to say I had to throw some trash away, so I had to go to the dump. And during the day, I'm focusing a lot on Jesus and then also on Anandamaya Ma. And I was like focusing on, like, as if I were conversing with Jesus. And I say, okay, Jesus, what do I ask you? What question can I ask you? And then I just said, Jesus, you know, there's this guru that I just stole my heart away, Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma. But then I went speechless. I couldn't ask him any questions. I didn't know what to say. There's nothing I can say. I just went absolutely speechless. And I stayed that way for quite some time. That's how I get. Just mention the name Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma. I really can't say anything at all, because there's nothing you can say that would do any justice at all. So I was having this sort of inner darshan of Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma as I'm driving around, and just in silence. So I get to the dump to throw my trash away, and I got there and I said, you know what, I feel really, really lucky. I feel sure I'm going to find something here at the dump. It's going to be really, 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 really great. And I think it has something to do with golf also. I said, maybe I'll find some golf clubs today. That's what I got out and I'm looking around. There's all this trash everywhere here, this side, and right where I am. And so I'm looking very intently where I am, very carefully, and I scan everything. I'm walking around looking very carefully. I said, wow, there's nothing. And I look again and again, and nothing, nothing, nothing. Not even a trace of anything. And I said, wow, I was wrong. I was so sure I was going to find something really, really amazing here. And I didn't. And I said, well, that's very peculiar. I said, usually I have this feeling, it turns out to be right. I really had a powerful feeling I'm going to find something. And especially, it seemed to hone in on some sort of golf club situation. But there's nothing there. And there wasn't that much around. It was easy to see what's there. And there was nothing there. So I said, well, I guess I was wrong. I guess I was wrong. I was kind of disappointed. Couldn't trust my intuition. I said, I guess I can't trust my intuition. And then I start to get ready to unload my trash, and I look at my feet there, right there. I'm standing right there. I look right down, right at my feet right there. And I say, what is that? What's going on here? And there was this single golf club just right there at my feet. And I said, wait a minute. That golf club wasn't there Before, when I was looking, I looked right there where it was. I was right. I mean, must have looked at it 10 times. There's no golf club there. So I kind of hesitated from what I said. What's going on here? I couldn't possibly have missed that. I looked very carefully for golf clubs. There was no trace of them. No trace of them. I was hoping someone would throw some golf clubs away. Nothing. And yet, suddenly, there's this singular golf club, not near anything else, not completely incongruent where it was. The trash around it had nothing to do with sports or somebody throwing away golf clubs or anything like that whatsoever. I said, "This is really odd." Completely incongruent where I found it. It's like someone just placed it there, for me. And so I finally grabbed it and I said, "What is this?" I said, "It's a 9 iron." I looked at it, I said, "Yamaha." I said, "Yamaha? I've never heard of Yamaha. Yamaha. SX25 Tour Forging." And I said, "Huh. That's odd too. It's not. It seems like a pretty good club. It's forged, turf forged iron." I said, "What the heck is somebody throwing away a single turf forged iron right there with other stuff that did not come from any sort of household? It was an industrial kind of waste and something. It had nothing to do with anyone cleaning out their garage, throwing away a golf club or anything. And I was sure it wasn't there when I was looking for it." And then I said, "Looked at the name, Yamaha. Ya means yes, ma, ha, like laughing." Now I had asked Ananda, my ma. I said, "You've got to manifest, please manifest. You've got to manifest. You've got to manifest." I didn't say what she had to manifest, and so I think she had a little joke at my expense. And later on, when I got home and I cleaned it up and I researched it, and this is a heck of a great club, actually. Probably from like 1990, 89, 90. And I swung it and I said, "Holy cow, this is a fabulous club. It's a better than any club I have in my bag." Who in the heck would throw such one club like this? I mean, what is going on here? And I actually took the 9 iron out of my bag and I put this in. I said, "This thing," and swinging it, I said, "I absolutely love this club. It's one of maybe the best club I've ever swung in my life. The balance, the feel, everything. I'm going to use this for my chipping iron. Okay, my pitching iron, my chipping iron, and my 9 iron. Extraordinarily great club." Never even knew Yamaha made golf clubs, but Hal Sutton used them back when he was really, really great. He was the Yamaha tour player, and this muscle back forged iron actually was renamed the Hal Sutton grind, I think, in 90, 91. So, what I'm saying is that Anandamayi manifested this club for me because it absolutely was not there when I was looking for it. I turned my back, I turned around, there it was right at my feet. And the name of it, Ya, yes, Ma, yes, it's coming for me. Ha! There's a little humor. She's very humorous and playful. And she says, "You want me to manifest? I just manifested for you. And I manifested something for you you're really going to like. And it's going to propel you, and it's already given me tremendous confidence." And And the other club it was coming in the mail. It came this afternoon, and it's fabulous. And so then, ready to leave, I said, "Holy cow, it's a miracle!" And my mom manifested this golf club for me. Had to have. There's no other explanation I can come up with that remotely fits. And then this guy drives up in a truck. He jumps out, and he says, "I can't believe today. I can't believe it. I can't believe it." He's yelling at me. He says, "Two flats in one day. I have had two flats in one day." He said, "How could it be any worse, huh?" And I said, "Well, it can only get better then, right?" And then he says, "You know what? I bet a seagull's going to poop on my head." And I told him, "Hey, if it does, you know what it means? It's good luck. It's really good luck. Really, really good luck." And so then I went home, and I ended up taking two irons, flat blades, so to speak, two irons out of my bag. Two irons. I took my 5-iron and my 9-iron out of my bag, and I replaced it with this iron and the one that came in the mail. And it made my set way stronger, way, way stronger. So the guy that came up, and there was nobody else around, just us two, and the way he acted, I said, "Somebody's putting him up to this. I guarantee you, this comes from the Holy Spirit." I mean, the way he was yelling at me and gesturing and everything, he was making a big, and he kept doing a big, big deal. And when I left, he put up two fingers. He said, "Two fingers like that," and I ended up taking two clubs out of my setup and changing them. In other words, you get two flat tires, you change into two new tires. That's exactly what I ended up doing when I got home. So, I have been focusing on Sri Sri Anandamayi a lot for 20 years, but recently I really feel she's been coming to me in dreams. I'm aware she's orchestrating stuff. She is really, really helping us out in a huge way. And I've been telling her, "You've got to manifest. You've got to manifest. You've got to manifest." I'm praying that she manifests. But now she's playing her little games, which are wonderful. And she says, "You didn't say what I had to manifest." Okay, you want me to manifest? I just manifested for you. I just manifested for you this fabulous golf club. And I knew intuitively that was going to happen because I got that up. I said, "I know I'm going to find something really important. Today's my lucky day. And I feel it's got something to do with golf. And I feel I'm going to find, something to do, golf club or golf clubs." I didn't know one or many, but I'm going to find some golf clubs today. It's just going to happen. And then I was so disappointed. I said, "Nothing, nothing. There's absolutely nothing here." And then boom, this suddenly shows up at my feet. So this club is in my bag, and every time I see it, it's going on to the course with me. And every time I see it, I said, "Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, the greatest guru there's ever been in this world." Perfect avatar. Perfect avatar. Now, in this book, Jesus says something. Dialogue on Awakening. Tom Carpenter asked Jesus about his life, and I'm very surprised because Jesus said that he struggled during his life, and he was tempted by the ego and had ego gave him troubles, and it was only on the cross that finally finished what he came for, and was able to completely identify with the one mind. They call it the Christ mind, the Christ, completely identify with it. So I was very surprised by that. Now I always say that the Christ, the one mind, brought Jesus into the world to play this game of pretending. And I would say, well, if that was the case, Jesus, if you had struggled with the ego, then how did you do all those miracles of healing and walking on water, raising the dead, etc.? So, but we have to take him at his word here that he had times where he struggled here. Because the ego he couldn't completely identify with the Christ mind while here. He had difficulties until he was finally on the cross, and he finally let go, and he realized being on the cross and not being on the cross are the same. is the same. Like Lanchenpa says, samsara and nirvana are the same in intrinsic spaciousness. And he had this full realization at that point and completely identified with the Christ mind. But in the case of Sri Sri Nanamayama, that wasn't the case. She never didn't come here because of any karma or any. She was completely identified with the Christ mind. He said before she was born, while she was born, after she was born, after she was growing up, after she grew to, you know, through childhood, young woman, after she got married, as she aged, you know, as she got older. He says, and then after she says, after I leave here, still the same. She says, exactly the same, perfectly identified with as the Christ mind, as the one mind. So that's why I call her the greatest guru there's ever been, avatar. Which is why when I bring my attention to her, there's really nothing I can say. It doesn't occur to me to ask her any questions at all. So I was wondering what was going to happen today, because the practice that I did was the best practice I've ever done by far, and it was absolutely staggeringly profound. And I said, wow, I don't know what's going to happen today, but it could be anything. I was sure some big miracle was going to take place today, because I said that practice I did was astonishing. The new way, just astonishing. The kind of assertions and affirmations I was making, the breakthroughs I was having, I said, wow, it is going to be an unprecedented day. And yet I thought nothing had happened until suddenly this golf club showed up at my feet. So we're getting a lot of help here, and it behooves us to keep practicing and to keep pushing here. You don't know what's going to happen. We're talking about these uber Dharma King gurus here. And in this book, Tom asked Jesus, based on what you said, Jesus, it sounds like it would be easy for someone who's passed on. He asked Jesus, have you been back here since you left 2,000 years ago? He said, no. Have you had a body? He said, no, I haven't. He said, did you have bodies before? He said, yes, I did. That's another difference. Sri Sri Nanamayama had never been here before, had never been in any sort of form-based appearance before, ever. She said she came straight from the formless, totally formless, and had never ever been in a world before or anything like that before. It was all brand new to her. And she said she did it because we asked her. We wanted her to, and we wanted something, some goddess archetype or someone who, like that, to come, and somehow she decided to appear here in this world. But Jesus said he did have previous lives to the before the life of Jesus here. Kind of easier then to identify with Jesus, isn't it? That he went through repeated lives and struggling with misidentification, struggling with pretending, until finally he was able to get free of it. So it's you know, Jesus is every one of us, so to speak. But the avatar is a different story. However, the avatar is really what we truly are, the one mind, having never ever been, how would you put it? I'm already that. Nothing's ever happened. Showing us reassuring us that nothing's ever happened. We've just been pretending to dream. And we're exactly like her, exactly like that. So I don't know what to say. It's been quite a day. Even the grip is fabulous in this club. Everything is fabulous about it. The waiting, the swinging. I said, oh my gosh, this is just amazing. It's like made for me somehow. And I've always bemoaned the fact, I said, how come they get all these miracles in the East, you know, and we don't get any here in the West? Well, we're starting to get them. And it suits Sri Sri Nandamaya Ma to do something like this, because you never knew what she would do. And we would think, well, she's going to give you like a mala, you know, a bead necklace or a relic of hers or a flower or something spiritual, you know. No, not necessarily. In another video, I just said she'd do whatever her KO, whatever intuition told her to do, whatever was appropriate for you, she would do just that. And who's to say that this might not have some very, very spiritual significance as far as my lifestyle goes, as far as a lot of things, like a trigger. Who's to say this isn't a trigger for me? For me. So she knew that. See, she knows exactly like that for each one of us. Astonishing. So I continue to have miracles in my life. Some really quite astonishing. Chando Sering Chodron, the spiritual counselor of Jamin Khensi Choki Lodro, showing up physically, walking down a sidewalk and laughing at my practicing. It basically said, you're already there. You know, Dzogchen, you're already there. Practice that you're already there. Believe you're already there. Believe you're already there. Don't mess around trying to get there. Believe you're already there. In other words, practice this, I'm already that. Samsara and Nirvana are the same, and I don't have to get rid of anything. I'm already there. Seeing St. Jude walking along the sidewalk, manifesting. I said, wow. So there's lots of miracles actually happening here. And throughout history, of course, the West has had a lot of miracles. It's just recently, it just doesn't seem like we've had that many. You know, some people see Jesus in a piece of cinnamon bread or something, or Mama Mary in a potato, or, you know, or some syrup or something. But, you know, that's subject to some bit of interpretation there, kind of like a Rorschach test or clouds. I saw Jesus in the clouds. Well, maybe they did. I'm not saying they didn't. But sometimes you see figures that look like, you know, something. And maybe they did. Maybe Jesus did put that there as a miracle. But something like this is somewhat of a different classification. Or seeing Chando Sering Chodron walking down a sidewalk is a different classification of miracle. These are, you know, big time miracles, actually, really big time. And of course, the club has signs of aging and stuff. But it's in fabulous, fabulous condition. So manifestations are not going to necessarily be brand new. They're going to look like they're just normal stuff, like they've been in the world, been used, etc. But this hasn't been used very much, I'll tell you that. It's just an amazingly beautiful condition. Amazingly beautiful condition. Prime of life, this club. Prime of life, but so old, you know, back 20, maybe 28 years old. But the reviews of these irons, they said they were absolutely fabulous. Absolutely fabulous. Some guy said, you know what? I borrowed my friends. He had some. He borrowed. He said, that's the best club I've ever hit. Best clubs I have ever, ever hit. These irons are just fabulous. Never even heard of them. So don't be surprised if you start experiencing miracles. We should. The way that we're practicing now in the new way, this is the new way, and we're coming up on the 1 month anniversary of it. This is the 20th, started on the 22nd of May this year, 2017. This is a super advanced situation. It's the new way, and so we're just getting our feet wet about what's going to happen. It's a really a new dispensation is what has happened. We have gone into a new dispensation, so the old rules don't apply so much, really. We don't know what's going to happen. We have to keep an open mind. And I kept saying, Sri Sri Nanama, Nanama, how about a manifestation? I mean, can you manifest? You know, how about a manifestation? Well, she did. She did. I didn't stipulate. I want you, specifically you, appearance of you, to manifest. She might be saying, maybe you're not ready for that. But I will manifest you something for sure. And how fortunate we are that we have thousands of pictures of her, right? And videos. She was here in most of the 20th century. How extraordinary is that? How fortunate we are, and how wise it is to call upon her. Now, I call upon Jesus 24/7, but there are times when I also call upon Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma. I don't want to leave her out of the equation. I mean, we need all the help we can get. So now Tom asked Jesus about it. Those of you who have left, like Jesus left, and he hasn't been back, he said the last 2,000 years, he hasn't been in a body, identified with a body at all. And then Tom said, well, look, I mean, the way you explain everything to me, it sounds like, you know, couldn't those who, like yourself, who have fully identified with the Christ mind and all that, and isn't it possible that those like you could actually appear in this world with a body temporarily for a short while if you wanted to? And Jesus said, absolutely. And he said, as a matter of fact, it's extremely simple to do. You might think it's very complex manifesting, but he says, actually, from my standpoint, it's extremely simple. Piece of cake. So Jesus was emphatically said, yes, those like myself absolutely can appear here, bodily appear in this world whenever they want to. And it's easy, easy, easy for them. And they certainly have done that. Lots of historic documentation of that in various religious traditions. So this type of experience certainly is quite stunning. and I really don't know what to make of it. So I just wow it. It is wow. Okay, I expect to be. I said I expect to be. I started the day. I expect to be wowed today. Really, really wowed. So all day long, I kept saying, "Okay, I'm gonna be wowed, wowed, wowed." Well, I was. And I also did 60 fast push-ups. That was good. I said, wow, pretty good, pretty good, pretty good. They're the easy type, but to do 60 rapid ones, and I wasn't that tired. I mean, I could have done probably some more, but I said, why, you know, why really press it? You know, that's enough. My breathing was right. Technique was just right. I mean, I look at my breathing technique, really, really perfectly aligned with the exercise, and that helps a lot. Now, in the past, people would speak about the miracles they experienced all the time. It was maybe the most common topical conversation there was, all the miracles that were happening. And right now, these days, in just the contemporary Silicon Valley culture, for instance, here, you're never going to hear of miracles. It's like my whole life here in this world, it's been like a vast desert, a desolate desert, where no one ever mentions miracles at all around me. Has anyone ever come up to me and say, you know, there's this tremendous miracle that's just taken place, or this miracle that... Now they use it in a secular context. Oh, I found what I was looking for, what a miracle, you know, that kind of thing. To kind of trivialize it. So, it's like, it's sort of taboo, by simply excluding it. You know, if no one stipulates it's taboo so much, but it sort of gets swept under the rug and nobody really says anything about it. And we just sort of feel it's kind of become taboo just because nobody references it anymore. And it's sort of like really outdated. It's kind of like out of fashion so severely that it's seemed to be, well, that was just sort of a fashion of the time back then to be that way, but it's not that way now. I asked a friend of mine, a good Christian friend, how you doing? And I told him, I'm not sleeping. He says, I'm not either. I can't sleep. I can't sleep. I said, wow, same here. I mean, it's really amazing, isn't it? But I said, that's okay. I'll practice all night long. And I don't know what the ultimate results of this, but it was just a stunning, absolutely stunning. The new way is absolutely amazing. The capacity we have to practice in ways that we could only dream about, vaguely dream about before, now we're actually doing, and doing very, very well. So 16 days of doing this, if you count the fourth and this day, maybe 17 days, of just doing every day, actually. So we just have to enjoy the play. The one mind is very creative, very playful, with a great sense of humor, and it's amazing. It does exactly what needs to do for us. But it doesn't. It's not trying to prove anything, so to speak. Prove itself. So it just does exactly what's right to help us out. And it is aware of our reactions of like, huh? And it probably gets a good laugh out of it, so to speak. It's looking and, you know, just like, ah, you know. The play, the Leela, the play of grace. I find that we have this wonderful creative sense of humor and play about our spirit, our spirits that way. So maybe she's laughing, having a good laugh, and say, "Oh, you didn't expect that. I expected it. It was there. It didn't come. Now it's there." And it's like, "Wow!" And it's like, you know, like having a good chuckle. It's like at my reactions and my kind of scratching my head about it all. But I took it in stride. I took it in stride. I said, "You know what? Absolutely, that is going in my bag, no question about it. In a prominent place. I put it next to my putter so you can see it prominently all the time right there." I said, I'm using this as my chipping iron. I'm just going to grab my putter and this and forget about a wedge. I'm just going to use this. It's perfect for that. Little chips, little pitches, little bump and runs, all that. Wonderful. So, we have to realize that the grace of God is playing this play of the spiritual path with us, getting us more and more accustomed to miracles. And so we need to become more and more accustomed to miracles, and we needn't say what they have to be, actually. You just keep an open mind and say, "You know, I'm asking for miracles today, whatever they may be. I'm not asking for anything specific at all, but I'm definitely asking for a lot of miracles." And that's the way I tend to go at it. I don't ask for specific stuff. And you can always say, not only am I entitled to miracles, as A Course in Miracles says, you might say that I have nothing but miracles. Everything works out for me perfectly. It's impossible for me not to have constant miracles. You know, reframe it. So you're saying that it's already the way it is. We don't have to ask for them. It's certain. It's certain. Absolutely certain that a constant stream of miracles will be my experiencing. In fact, it already is. Practice this way. Reshape your expectations. A constant stream of miracles are my constant companion. And you can say it's always been that way. In fact, it couldn't be any other way for me. It's impossible it'd be any other way. So practice like that. Don't be a beggar. We're the oneness of God. Don't be a beggar. State the fact that you are this oneness of God. So I'm never without miracles. That's already the way it is. In fact, it's always been that way. It's always been that way. Talking about vision. Guru vision. Say, I've always had guru vision. I've never not had it. So refuse to try to say, "Well, I want to change something. I don't have guru vision now, but I need to change to that." Refuse to say that, because that's the ego's game. Just insist, "No, I already have guru vision. Of course, it's the only vision that is possible, and I've always had it. I've never not had it. Now I've had a false perception of it." Pretending I don't, but I've still had it, you see. I've still had it all along. So I've always had guru vision. And so we're reshaping our expectations to just say, "Of course, it's just normal. What do you mean? It couldn't be otherwise. It couldn't be otherwise." So we reshape our expectations in such a way as we're really stating, "Of course, it's impossible. It couldn't be otherwise. No way could it be otherwise. Of course I have guru vision. Of course I have miracles. There's no way that could ever be otherwise." And so by reshaping expectations to say, "Well, this is completely normal. I mean, of course I expect this. How could I not expect it?" Then that lays the foundation for truly experiencing it. As Jesus said, we don't have to do anything. We just have to give up false perception of what we're already doing. We're already enlightened. We're already awake. Jesus says we're already awake. We're just trying to perceive ourselves as not awake and have this dream of attempting to do this, dream of abnormality, or dream of inducement, trying to induce abnormality. But really, we're still very much awake, completely awake. It's like when we misperceive something, and we like think that a blueberry rolling across the floor is some spider or an insect going across the floor. Well, and then we see the blueberry and say, "Oh, it's a blueberry." Well, it was never an insect going across the floor, right? It was all the blueberry is always there. But as long as we're misperceiving what is there, we're thinking that we need to do something to our misperception to transform it in somehow. But Jesus is saying, don't try to transform anything. Don't try to modify anything. Just say, I can't modify anything. It's impossible for you to modify anything. Because we can't modify reality. It's always here. We're just pretending to misperceive it. So I don't have any plans at the moment. I'll just go with the miracles, yeah, whatever miracles arrive. And just, in fact, practicing. All miracles have already arrived. I've already received all the miracles. I'm already benefited from infinite miracles. Nothing, no trouble can ever possibly befall me. I cannot suffer need at all. It's impossible for me to suffer need. Miracles are constantly flowing into my experiencing. My experiencing is already perfect. My experiencing has always been perfect. Now you have to understand that these Dharma kings, their whole purpose is this natural compassion. And so they love nothing more than to help us out. But they can't help us out unless we call upon them and open our mind and are willing to be shocked by their help. Do you think they're saying, I hope nobody asks me for help, you know, I'm really tired of helping, I don't want to help anymore, and try to close their... Do you really think it's like that? Or are they absolutely intent on the slightest call for help to, boom, answer it like that? They're like a border collie. You know, throw me the ball. And the border collie is just like, they have the most amazing attention. And they can hold it for such long periods of time. They'll just sit, lie there, watch it. You have a ball or something, or a frisbee, and they never take their attention off you. Their attention is riveted to you. Until you indicate that you're not going to do it, they won't budge. Their attention just remains absolutely riveted to you. It's amazing. So the Dharma kings are like border collies. They're saying, throw me the ball. I'll go get it. Throw me the ball. That's what I'm all about. Now, that club, the other club I got, it's a 2-3 hybrid. You could set it at different lofts. I put it at 16.5 draw. And I realized that this club is going to radically change my golf game, as is this one. These two clubs radically changed my golf game. It's not going to be the same at all. And I went through my mind playing this course. I said, holy cow, I could hit it like eight different times probably this club. I don't even need to use my driver right now on that course. Don't even need to use it. I said, wow, it's what we call a game changer, a real game changer. That you can have this like 16.5 club in a hybrid style with a shorter shaft, easier to control, easier to hit straight, and yet you can I realize I can hit the ball a long way with this, a long way, but really much more accurately than even a 3-wood. And so I said, really, I don't even have to hit a 3-wood on a lot of these holes. I'll just hit this. That's what the pros do, actually. They'll hit like a 2 hybrid, and they'll just pump it out there, 240 or something. I mean, really accurate. I mean, they'll hit it a long way. They'll hit it a long way. Maybe even 250. I don't know, but I've seen them. And I said, wow, that's, when you've got that going for you, it's a game changer. So I'm aware that the whole, my whole game has just been, really altered. Changing the tools, just like the new way, changing the tools, changing the way we practice, has really altered our game. Our spiritual path has really altered it. It's fundamentally lifted it up to a much, much, much higher degree. But I'm in no hurry. I have no plans. Just take it one day at a time. Keep practicing. Keep working out, and we'll see how the next miracles what they're like. And we practice. Say they're already here and they're fantastic. They're wonderful. See, pretend that you've already stopped pretending. Pretend the miracles are already here and they're just wonderful. And I'm just having an absolute, my life is just immeasurably enriched, already. Don't wait for it. Assert it right now. You already have that. You already have it. There's right use of imagination. Okay. I already have it. Right use of imagination, right use of pretending. So instead of asking for some vacation, imagine that you already have it. Or even that you've already come back from it. It was like it was just absolutely extraordinary. It was better than anything I could even expect, way beyond my expectations. Wow. Tremendous. And then just feel gratitude about it. So don't be a beggar. Feel gratitude that you've already received. Feel gratitude that you've already received. Let no doubt enter your mind. Let no doubt enter your mind. You have already received. You've already been so elevated. And now you really know. It's impossible that I could ever suffer need, ever suffer want, ever suffer deprivation in any way. Totally impossible. I can never suffer at all, as a matter of fact. I can never suffer at all. This club is pretty high tech, really, in a lot of ways. It's old school, and it's better. It's better. It's got a very good shaft, True Temper, Dynamic Gold, S4000, S400 rather, S400. Very good shaft. It's in great shape. I know this club is, I just know it's going to work tremendously. No doubt about it. Don't even have to hit it to know that. It just feels completely right in my hands. Well, custom made, custom delivered to me by the great golfsmith, Sri Sri Anandamayama, the great golfsmith. The great golf pro says, here, I want you to try this club. I think this will help your game. So hopefully I can sleep tonight. I don't think I'm going to practice too much tonight. I mean, some, if I wake up, I will. But, you know, I almost have to catch my breath a little bit from yesterday with all the taping I did and the practicing all night. It was like a marathon, and it was really, really profound. The shockwaves are continuing, and let us not imagine we're second-class spiritual citizens here. Okay. We're starting to move into that groove where we're now first-class spiritual citizens. We're now going first class. See, we're not traveling. We're not traveling along with the baggage. We're not traveling economy class. Okay. We're now traveling first class. First class. Not second-class spiritual citizens anymore. So this is a big, big step for us here, especially in the West. Especially in the West. In modern times, right? It used to be different, but the Renaissance, starting with the Renaissance, things really changed. And ultimately, we've arrived at this situation we have now in the world, which is, we know what it's like. They don't even want to let you on the plane, let alone baggage class, you know. They don't want to let you on the plane, the spiritual plane. But here we are now, flying first class. We're flying first class, finally. How about that? Hallelujah. We're finally flying first class. We can say, I'm an absolutely first class spiritual citizen. I can't be anything other than that. I've always been that. I could never be anything other than an absolute top-notch first-class spiritual citizen. I have no choice in it. I can't possibly be anything other than that. Can I possibly be anything other than that? So this changes our expectations, right? To be in alignment with that. The ego will say, well, that's not fair. You know, you're doing what works. The ego says, wants you to fail. He says, that's not fair to me. I mean, if you did it over here, you'd fail. That's fair to me. Well, we can't please everyone, ego, you know. Fair to you is unfair to God, Spirit, what I am. So We're going to catch hell either way. Might as well catch hell doing what we really love, right? Really, really love truth. So the ego's going to say, oh, that's not fair. That's working, what we're doing. That's practice actually working. You're actually working on your expectations directly. Says, no, you can't do that. That's not fair. Meaning, uh-oh, that really works. I can't stop it. The ego says, that's fair, I can't stop that. And you want me to stop it, so you need to be fair to me. And I say, well, I don't want you to stop it right now, ego. So maybe later I'll tell you to stop it and be fair to you, but not right now. And the ego say, well, okay. But it'll say, you're kind of weird, you keep changing your mind. Well, yeah, as we gather our resolve more and more, we keep taking better and better steps. The ego just reflects our fear back to us. If we're not afraid, there's no reflection, nothing to reflect. So it seems like the ego just goes kind of quiet. See, it's okay to be quiet a lot. You don't constantly have to be saying something or thinking something. It's good to be this quiet, like you're stunned, like you're shocked, like this is just, you're experiencing, is quite extraordinary. And my experiencing has been this last month. Tremendously extraordinary. In fact, it's been a month to this day now that we arrived at our vacation destination, and it was just tremendous beyond expectations, for sure. Real shocker. 1 month. And from that day forward, it has just been non-stop extraordinary. What an extraordinary month it's been. May 20th to June 20th. So the next month, from the to July 20th, is, we're saying, wow. Already we say, wow, that was the most miraculous month ever. It topped everything. So a certain that practice in this way. There's nothing I can do to prevent this next month from being the best month I've ever had. For sure, it will be the best, by far and away the best month I've ever experienced in my life, the most extraordinary month I've ever experienced, ever. Wow. Wow, what a glorious month, an absolutely glorious month. So practice like that. This month will go down in history as the greatest month ever. No doubt about it. So put yourself behind the engine of that kind of super confidence, all right, and drive that vehicle. And be certain when you go to sleep, your dreams are going to be life-changing. They'll be so tremendous, tremendous boosts. Absolutely extraordinary. Okay, so. Wow. You see, you start wowing right now. Start wowing the next month right now. Don't wait for it to happen. Say that it's already happened exactly as the Holy Spirit wants it. And it's It's exactly, it's exceeded our expectations to such an extraordinary extent. We're already in the wow. We're already in the wow of it. It is so amazing that the wow actually reverberates back to right now, and like, we're already in the wow of this next month, right? We're already in the wow of that big time wow. So let your mind be very open to the next month. We realize not only is anything possible, that everything's possible. It's all. It most certainly will happen. Our expectations will be tremendously exceeded. No question about it. It's 100% certainty. It's already happened. My expectations have already been tremendously exceeded by this next month. There's no way I can avoid it. Absolutely no way I can avoid it. There's nothing I can do about it. It's certain to happen. Absolutely certain to happen. Tell yourself like this. Okay. So, practice, 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 practice. And do not let even a shred of doubt touch you. Not a shred of doubt, just the opposite. So. So, with Sri Sri Nandamayama, I would say, here for me, just this silence, just like feeling like, you know, what she's going to do is going to be so immense, so extraordinary. I'm speechless. There's nothing I can say about it. No way I can even describe it. It's going to be so helpful that just being just silent about it says it all. Leaving me speechless. No question, this will take place again and again and again. Same with Jesus Christ. What he's going to do for us this next month has already left us speechless. Speechless with just silent gratitude and silent confidence. So last month I used that. I was certain that what we wanted to happen would happen against all odds, without any way of knowing how. I was said, I know it's going to happen. There's no question about it. I don't know how it's going to come together, but it most certainly will. And I'm going to prepare as if that is it's a done deal. For sure it will. And it did. And it was just an amazing, amazing month. So we're going to even outdo that this month. No limits upon it. No limits upon it. No limits upon it. So start wowing the next month right now. Wow, wow, and wow.